I love Star Trek, which is why I hate bad Star Trek. And guess what? We're on another Star Trek series, Star Trek Voyager. So, what's a good Star Trek episode without time travel?
I shouldn't be listening to details about the future.
And a self-righteous, ridiculous message about the Prime Directive.
Take my advice. It's less of a headache if you just ignore it.
Yay! If we got people coming back from the dead, we have the Star Trek trifecta. What is this we're talking about? Star Trek Voyager, time and again. With the Voyager voyaging, that's what the show's all about, and we see that Tom and Harry have a double date with the Delaney sisters. We'll see them once or twice throughout the series, but we'll hear about them a lot more. Apparently, Harry is reticent to go on a double date because he has a girlfriend at home. We'll see more about that non sequitur. Tom, of course, wants to go on the date, presumably because he wants to go on a date with the sister and not Harry, but then we're getting into SF debris territory, and I'm going to leave that joke to him. Suddenly, a shockwave hits Voyager, and Cass in bed senses something.
Yeah, Cass is this series' Troy.
But better than Troy.
That's not hard.
Well, that's what you get for not having your name in the opening credits. Ha ha ha.
Are you familiar with any intelligent life forms in this system, Mr. Neelix?
And Neelix knows nothing. Well, that's Neelix. Although, let's talk about Neelix really quick. A lot of Star Trek fans really hate Neelix. I don't really like Neelix, I don't really hate Neelix. He's a character. He has good points and bad points. And so Cass, for no reason at all, comes to the bridge.
And now...
No. No, what?
The origin of the shockwave is an M-class planet, Captain. We're within visual range.
On screen.
Apparently this planet's entire civilization just destroyed itself with some new energy called choleric energy. I sense an allegory!
Social commentary!
Does that really count? Because it's not Gene Roddenberry anymore, but it's still the same idea of Gene Roddenberry. Can we do that?
I think you can do that.
Okay, we'll go with that then.
Mr. Paris, Tuvok, you're with me. Miss Torres, meet us in transporter room 2. On my way. Commander, you have the bridge.
And Janeway walks right off the bridge without even noticing the unauthorized people 2 feet away.
So Cass is all weepy, and Neelix doesn't understand what's going on. All he can do is comfort her. It smelled like bacon. Delicious applewood smoked bacon. You got breakfast? So down on the planet...
Look. This may be some kind of timepiece. Stopped at the moment of the explosion.
Tom shifts suddenly into a busy street. And back again. And back again! And back again! So B'Elanna suddenly verifies that he has in fact shifted to a different time, and so Janeway calls for the crew to beam back to the ship. But not before, they're back again!
Tuvok,
B'Elanna, Janeway! Oh! Oh! It's like Mariah Carey!
Mariah Carey slept with a Nazi!
Oh!
Hey, calm down. It's all right.
So this is the little brat. He doesn't have a name, he's just the brat. And let me say something really quick. I love kids. I've been a Sunday school teacher more than half my life. Kids love me, I love them. That being said, I want to strangle this kid with his own intestines.
They're some kind of demons. I saw them with my own eyes.
I'm sorry we startled them. We just came around the corner.
They're lying.
I do. And so Tom sees the same clock he was checking out a moment earlier in the future.
Wait, why are they using Arabic numerals?
Well, you see...
What do these numbers stand for?
Rotations, intervals, fractions. Same as any timepiece.
So apparently, according to this clock, Janeway and Paris are less than a day away from doom! Meanwhile, back on Voyager, the crew decide to wait for Janeway to activate a signal because they don't know where she is, or more accurately, when she is. So most of our heroes are going to sit around and wait for a couple other heroes to do something. It's a good start for Voyager, isn't it? So, even though this has nothing to do with the time travel story, this is early in the show's run, and so we need to establish the Doctor things. So Kes goes to sickbay to find out about her emerging psychic powers. And the Doctor finds out that neither Kes nor Neelix are known to him, nor have their medical profiles been updated. In fact, he doesn't even know about them. Or the Maquis crew that was brought aboard.
Seems I found myself on the voyage of the damned.
So the Doctor surmises that Kes's abilities are just natural.
Go home. Get a good night's sleep. And drink plenty of fluids.
Fluids?
Everybody should drink plenty of fluids.
So Janeway and Tom trade in their uniforms for some local costumes.
Yes, local costumes that all look exactly the same. Everybody in this civilization wears a broadly striped shirt in Fruit Loops colors.
Oh, wow! Orange, lemon, cherry, lime!
Berry! Kellogg's Fruit Loops cereal, a fruitful part of this complete breakfast.
No wonder they were recognized as foreigners before. They only had one stripe.
Maybe there's some way that...
Don't even think about it, Tom. The Prime Directive is clear. We cannot allow our presence to alter this planet's natural course of events.
Even if the natural course of events is annihilation?
Yeah.
Ah, get used to this. The Prime Directive. Captain Janeway will literally let a whole society be destroyed rather than violate the Prime Directive. Except for those times when she won't, because... she won't. And so we have seen time and again, which would fit why this mediocre episode is named as it is, that starship captains will just destroy whole civilizations to serve the Prime Directive without thinking about it. We're not talking about making a difficult choice. We're talking about deliberately not acting and not thinking because the rules say we can.
The law doesn't make mistakes.
And when we decide we want to intervene, we'll intervene. And whichever choice we make is the right choice because we're the captain. This is what is called in the business, bad writing.